Welcome to church this morning. Yeah, I think this every time I get up here. You know, I have these abilities, and the last place I want to be is in front of people. You know? But God gave me the gift, so I use them.
Amen, brother.
So welcome to church this morning. Welcome everybody on YouTube. Make sure to like, subscribe, leave a comment. That's the way we can interact with each other. And what?
Share.
Absolutely. We're very limited time, so let's get the most out of YouTube we can.
Amen, brother. Let us pray, church. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for coming into your house to learn about you and to worship you and to love you, Lord. Thank you very much for this church. We love you and we praise your name. Amen.
of every age, author of our faith, first and last the same, name above all names, crowned in majesty, glorious Prince of Peace, throne of God's right hand, the world at His command, the world at His command. Jesus, Lamb of God, how great You are. There is no other Savior. Every knee bows down at Your merciful High Priest, lover of the least, generous and meek, protector of the weak, sacrifice to death, for us Your final breath, You died the world to save, to overcome the grave, overcome the grave. Jesus, Lamb of God, how great You are. There is no other Savior. Every knee bows down at Your renown. There is no other Savior. You will reign forever. You reign forever. How great You are. There is no other Savior. Every knee bows down at Your renown. There is no other Savior. Jesus, Lamb of God, how great You are. There is no other Savior. Every knee bows down at Your renown. There is no other Savior. All I need is You, Lord.
Nothing like a gospel song, amen? We had a few of them, didn't we? Thank you, praise band. Woo, that's good. Who likes the praise music here at church? Amen. See how I'm getting those hands coming up? Let's see how many come up this time. If you read your Bible this week, raise your hand. Yeah, all right. Awesome. We're getting almost every hand up there. The peer pressure is working. And I'm okay with that. I'm okay with some positive peer pressure. Who's okay with some positive peer pressure? Yeah, yeah. People prompt you to do the right thing. That's good, isn't it? Yeah. Maybe if you want to do the wrong thing, it's not. Right? So, don't cheat yourself. Read your Bible every week. Can you believe it's the last Sunday in March? Right? But I'm ready for winter to be over. So it's... I get a bunch of amens coming all around. So I'm, so here, we're 8 weeks into the book of 1 Corinthians. So that time's flying by too. Last week was chapter 7, and the title of the sermon was You Are Qualified. And if you want to know what you're qualified for, check out the sermon, right? So you're qualified to be the witness of Jesus Christ. That's, if you are a born-again Christian, you are qualified to be God's witness. Always remember the YouTube channel is Get Solid TV. All services can be viewed there. There's links on Facebook, but if you go to the channel, you have all the options of all the services. Today we are in 1 Corinthians chapter 8, and the title of the sermon is where the rubber meets the road. Where the rubber meets the road. So it's an old saying, right? We've heard that many times, where the rubber meets the road. Have you ever really thought about the saying? Sometimes we say things without thinking about them. At least I do. Probably too much. Open mouth, insert foot, right? So I'm going to try not to do that today. But where the rubber meets the road is just a point of contact, right? That's what that is. The road is stationary, and the motorcycle is moving. Notice what I just did there, huh? Got motorcycle in here, so yeah, that's right. Could have been a car, but I chose motorcycle. So the road's stationary, the motorcycle's moving, yet they have this this little point of contact. Two points on a motorcycle, right? And they're very important. You go messing around with those points of contact, and you wreck your motorcycle. You know? So I was out on the mountains last summer, and I wasn't paying attention to my point of contact. And we rode so many miles that my back tire went bald, and I didn't even know it until I'm up on the top of the mountain and I about slide down the mountain, going around a curve. I'm like, whoa, what was that? Frost? Ice? Get off the bike? No, bald tire. So you go messing with the point of contact, bad things can happen. So the point of where the rubber meets the road as applying to this chapter is when spiritual realities meet the physical realm, it's a point of contact. You see what I mean? And sometimes when spiritual realities meet the physical realm, the results surprise us. They're kind of like I was surprised on my motorcycle. You know, the results can be surprising. So we're going to see if I can bring this out of the chapter, because it's a very interesting chapter, and I'll get into that right before we start reading. If you read the chapter, you kind of might be thinking it's a very interesting chapter, unless you studied it, and then you probably know what I know about it, which I will reveal to you. So close your eyes and pray with me real quick here. Let's ask Father God for a word of wisdom. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for time and place to gather and to worship you like we did, and thank you for being here in your presence with your Holy Spirit in each one of us. We always want to approach you with a heart of thanksgiving because we have so much to be thankful for. So we thank you for all those things in our lives that sometimes we don't thank you for. We do that now. And we thank you for your Bible. And we ask your word of wisdom here this morning. We ask that you anoint my lips to preach your word. Give us all supernatural ears to hear it with and a heart to receive it with. In Jesus' name, amen. So the chapter is very specific to the culture in Corinth. It doesn't have a direct application to our culture today. But even though it doesn't have a direct application, the concept that is taught here applies to all Christians everywhere. Real quick, the Greeks and the Romans, which was the culture of Corinth, they were polytheistic. Everyone remember that term maybe from history class in school, polytheistic? They believed in many gods. It wasn't just one god, there was a bunch of them. And the other thing, they were polydemonistic. They believed in all kinds of evil deities, right, that could do all kinds of interesting things. So they actually believed that evil spirits could enter human beings by attaching themselves to food. Doesn't that sound interesting? Yeah. And if the evil spirit could be removed from the food if you sacrifice part of that food to one of those gods. And then the food was safe to eat. So, sounds like a bunch of malarkey, right? It was. It was a bunch of malarkey. We know that. So it doesn't really apply to us here. Paul and the mature believers knew it was a bunch of malarkey. So, you know, they didn't really care. So if I ate food that was sacrificed to a make-believe God, so what? He doesn't exist anyway, right? Which is part of where Paul goes with this. But the so what is some believers, especially newer believers who just left that form of religion, they might be very offended or reminded or think that they're doing something wrong, you see, even because to them it isn't as make-believe as it is to you and I, as removed as we are from that culture. So I suppose there could be non-believers that might think the Christians were joining in their idol worship. You could think of that too, right? So here's the point of contact, where the spiritual reality is meeting the physical reality of what's going on there in Corinth. We're going to read just starting at verse 1 here in chapter 8. We'll see if I can pull this out. It's interesting. This was a hard chapter for me to get my head wrapped around, because there is no direct application. We simply do not sacrifice meat to idols here in this country. It's just, and to try and apply it to something specific that we do, there is no exact, you know, we would be twisting things. So, verse 1, "Now, as touching things offered unto idols, we know that we all have knowledge. Knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth." So he's starting out, he's still answering questions. He answered questions in the last chapter that they'd ask him about marriage. Now they're asking him questions about this. And he's like, now I'm going to answer your questions about this. But instead of going straight into the answer, notice what he does. He instantly shifts from practical to conceptual. The practical was the sacrificing of the meat to the idols. And the concept is knowledge or love, right? Knowledge is not the most important thing. Knowing everything about your Bible is not the most important thing. Yes, pick your jaw up off the ground. The pastor that says read your Bible every week just told you that that knowledge isn't the most important thing in a Christian's life. Love is. And that's what he says. He says knowledge can puff you up, but love will build you and other people up. So he wants to get that concept going. Verse 2. "And if any man think that he knoweth anything, he knoweth nothing yet as he ought to know." Yeah. Who's been a know-it-all at one time in their life? "If you think you know it all, you don't even know enough to understand that you don't know it all." It's kind of what he's saying. You don't even know enough to know you don't know it all, Mr. Know-it-all, right? "And if you don't understand that you should be concerned for others, then you don't have much godly knowledge anyway." It's kind of where he's going to take this. If you don't understand that you really should be concerned for other people, you don't quite know what you should know if you're a Christian. Okay, that's where he's going. Verse 3. "But if any man love God, the same is known of him." So here's the knowledge that counts. Remember I said knowledge wasn't the most important thing? Well, here's the knowledge that counts. Does God know that you love him? And so what does it say? Read it again. Short verse. "If any man loves God," if you love God, if you're saved, if you're born again, if you love God enough to believe in his one plan of salvation, you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, if that applies to you, then God knows that. He knows you. God's knowledge is what really counts. What God knows about you is what counts. You see what I'm saying? Does God know you love him? Does he know that? How does he know that? You obey him is one good way that, then the Bible says that. That's how we even know that we love God, if we obey God. And he also knows that if you've accepted Jesus Christ, God knows that. And because of that, you've expressed love towards God and you've allowed him to express his love towards you. Verse 4, and all we're here for is to talk about sacrificing meat to idols. And look where Paul's taking us. You see what I mean? Verse 4. "As concerning, therefore, the eating of those things that are offered in sacrifice unto idols," so now he'll get to the question after he's tried to shift a mindset here, "we know that an idol is nothing in the world, and that there is none other God but one." So there's the spiritual reality, right? The spiritual reality is there's only one God. You can sacrifice whatever you want to whoever you want to call them. You can call them Pluto, or, I mean, anyone got any interesting names for false gods? Dagon was in the Old Testament. I don't know. I was trying to think of something clever, but I can't. It's off the top of my head. Sarzar, I don't know, you know. There was something on Seinfeld where they made up a make-believe Christmas episode, you know. What's that? Zool, whatever. So the point is, they're fake. And Paul says, we know that. We know the spiritual realities, there's only one God. That's all there is. And that's where the rubber meets the road in Corinth, the spiritual reality being just one God, but the culture thinking there's all kinds of gods and doing all kinds of weird stuff for those gods, to those gods. So that's where the rubber's meeting the road. And I'm going to read the next couple verses without stopping, I think. We'll see. Verse 5. For though there be that are called gods, these false gods, lowercase god, whether in heaven or in earth, as there be gods many and lords many, he's saying they got all these false things, but to us there is but one God, the Father of whom are all things, and we in him, and one Lord, capital L, Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, and we by him. Spiritual realities abounding here. Verse 7, howbeit there is not in every man that knowledge. For some, with conscience of the idol unto this hour, eat it as a thing offered unto an idol, and their conscience being weak is defiled. So he's saying there are people who aren't in the knowledge set, right? Even maybe brothers and sisters in Christ that aren't fully vested. They're saved. It's hard to think about how they would still possibly think these idols could exist. But if God pulls you out of a thing, he's asking you to stop doing it, okay? If you got saved from the bar stool, okay, I'm not comparing this meat to drinking, okay, because I didn't want to make any comparisons. But if you got saved from the bar stool, you would feel bad if you went back to drinking, because God saved you from that. You see what I mean? That was, so this is the concept here, and it's a concept to try and wrap your head around. But even though you might think you might be in the right, you see what I'm saying? If your action harms somebody as a result, it's wrong. Does that make sense to you? Even though it might be okay for you to do something, if by doing it somebody else got harmed, it's wrong. Okay, so you could have two responses to that thought process, okay? And I thought about myself before I was saved and now, okay? You could have this response. If I'm in the right, I'm going to do it anyway. You see what I mean? Well, if I'm in the right, I'm doing it anyway. Or you could skip down to verse 13, like I'm going to ask you to, and you could see what Paul says is the Christian response. Paul says, wherefore, if meat make my brother to offend, I will eat no flesh while the world standeth, lest I make my brother to offend. Hold on one second. I didn't silence my phone. No one else heard it go off, but I did. Anyway, so let's read it again. Wherefore, if meat make my brother to offend, I will eat no flesh while the world standeth. That means forever. I won't ever do it, he says. That so my brother doesn't get offended or doesn't get injured by me. Paul gives the Christian response to the thought of something that you could do that's not necessarily wrong, but if it hurts somebody else, you probably shouldn't do it. That's the concept that's trying to come across in this chapter, because the sacrificing meats to idols doesn't apply to us here. So where the rubber meets the road, the important principle in the chapter is that we must not only consider what effect our actions have on ourselves, but just as important, what effect our actions have on other people. That's a Christian concept. That you would think that concept's built into the world, but it's not. But it is definitely a Christian concept. If you apply love to your decisions, you will consider the impact of your actions and what they have on other people. If you apply love. Now, you make what we used to call a knee-jerk reaction. Then you don't have time to apply love. And that's typically when drama happens, right? So it's a Christian concept. This is the Christian concept. And now that I have your attention, and now that I have you somewhat confused, let me muddy the waters even farther. Let me get you totally confused, okay? No, that's not what I'm trying to do. I'm actually trying to bring a little clarity, but let's see if it works. There are Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ, okay? Other Christians, brothers and sisters in Christ, who choose to be legalistic. They choose that, okay? They consider all kinds of things sin that are not named as sin in the Bible. There are people out there like that. Do you know that? You ever met any of them? They're out there. Okay. We've probably met some of them. So the concept in this chapter that I just explained, right, it is not a vehicle for legalism. That's what it is not. That's not what Paul is trying to get at here, because there's other places in the Bible where he comes against legalism very strongly. So this isn't a vehicle for legalism. So let me give you an example. Just because I might offend someone's legalism doesn't mean I made them stumble. You see what I'm saying? He's talking about making a weak stumble. He's not talking about making a holier-than-thou mad at you. You see what I mean? You can offend someone's legalism without making them stumble. That's not where this concept goes. So now we got to really weigh actions. You see, now I got to think about everything, right? Wow. If you're like me, you think, wow, this Christian walk is hard. I got to think all that stuff through. Yeah, it's hard. You're right. It is hard. It's not easy. No one said it was easy, right? The old, no one said it was going to be easy. It's a hard thing. You know, before I was a Christian, I just did what I wanted. Right? Who else? I just did what I wanted. I didn't care. I didn't care what other people thought. And if I'm honest, I didn't care if other people got hurt. Did I? I don't think I did. I mean, but now I got to care. Paul says, I got to care. That's what Paul's saying here. You got to care. It's exhausting. Makes you want to just stay home and never go anywhere, never talk to anyone. Then you won't be guilty of this. You won't have to ever make anyone stumble. Of course, you won't ever witness to anyone either. Right? So we have to, how are you going to get it done? Okay? God can do heart surgery on you. You know what I'm saying? God is quite a brilliant surgeon, by the way. He is. He makes these earthly surgeons look like amateurs. God can do heart surgery. He can take your cold, hard heart, and he can make it something new. Did you know that's true? It happened in my life. It's very true. It can happen, especially if you pray for it and you want that. You know, you can resist it. You can keep your hard heart for a long time, even after you're a Christian, if you resist it. You really can. But God, he's got the scalpel. He's waiting. Are they going to ask me? Do they want to care about other people? He wants you to. You know, you can feel God's love for other people. Did you know that? You can actually feel his love because the Holy Spirit in you. It's quite a deal. When you're in that place, when you have submitted to God, when you have asked God, God, give me your heart. Help me to reach out and love the lost enough to share the gospel. Help me to love my brothers and sisters enough to edify them, to build them up, not to make them stumble. You see, when you're in that place, that's when you really understand verse 13. What Paul said in verse 13. Because I think we read that verse and it doesn't mean to us what it meant to Paul when he said that. So I want to do just a little exercise. Just a little exercise for us here. It won't take long. We're going to get out early today. I can see that. That gives you hope. Maybe that'll get me more participation in my exercise. Because I say exercise, and I seen about half the people go, right? No, I'm not talking about jumping jacks. Okay. I want you to, as you're setting right where you're at, I want you to think about somebody that you love. Somebody that you really love. I want them, somebody that's still alive, not past and gone on me, but somebody that's here now that you really, really care about. Okay, just think of, get that person in your mind. Okay, now that you have that person in your mind, I want us to reread verse 13, and I want that verse to apply to that person. I want you to be Paul making the statement, and I want the this to apply to him. So, therefore, if meat maketh that person to offend, to injure them, if eating that thing made you offend or injure that person, he says, I will eat no flesh while the world standeth. I'll never do that. If that injures that person, I will never do that. You see what he says? Lest I make them injured. I won't do it. Did it work? Did it work for you? Does it make sense to you now what Paul's saying there? That's what he's trying to, this whole chapter was just trying to get them to that place. That they would never do anything to harm a brother and sister in Christ. You see what I mean? And so if you have it in your heart, if you really have God's love in your heart, you wouldn't do something to harm anyone. That person that you thought of, that you cared for so much, you'd feel that way about everyone. That's scary to think about, right? How would I be mad at people? Well, maybe you wouldn't. Maybe you'd be a little more forgiving. I mean, that's the whole deal. The whole book of Corinthians, I'm coming to realize, is Paul trying to make these people better witnesses. And how do you become a better witness? You become more Christ-like. Amen. You become more like the person you're trying to be the witness for. You become more like Jesus. And the closer you become to Jesus with your actions, with your heart, with your feelings, with your intentions, with what you want for people, the more effective a witness you are. It just shows. You don't have to act. You don't have to put on the show. You don't have to break the Bible out and turn to the verse. They just see it on you. It's like, wow, you know, something different about that guy. Well, and somebody else might tell him he's really a Christian. You ever had anyone say that about someone? They're really a Christian. As if there's some fake Christians running around. But if you don't have God's heart, if you haven't asked for that, you come off as fake. You see, if you really don't love people, you come across as fake. Because sharing the gospel is about loving people. And when you don't love people and you just giving them lip service, they know you're fake. Paul didn't want a fake church here at Corinth. He didn't want a church divided. He didn't want a church fighting amongst each other. How could they ever be a witness for Jesus if they were doing that? And he didn't want a church that didn't care for one another. This chapter was about caring for the people they were going to church with. Hey, you know what? Yeah, we know it's all a bunch of crap and you could eat that meat and it's never going to hurt you. But if it hurts your brother that you're going to church with, why would you do it? Just don't do it. And once again, it wasn't about legalism. So that's really all I have from this chapter. God wants you to be a better witness. That's just what it boils down to. And the way of being a better witness is loving the people you're witnessing to. It's a real simple Christian concept. It's where the rubber meets the road, quite honestly. If you open your mouth to be a witness for Christ and you don't love the person you're talking to, it's not going to work. They're not going to see Jesus in you. I'm not saying God might not still work through what you say. You might plant a seed that leads them somewhere else, but they're going to know that you don't really care about them. Next week, because I made the announcement here, but the people on YouTube don't know. Next week we will have Pink returning to the pulpit after 5 years or so. And he's given us a reading assignment, which is Philippians chapter 1. So we're going to take a little break from 1 Corinthians. And probably when we come back, we'll be taking a break. Pink will make the announcement next week as to what chapter we're going to. But we're getting really close to Resurrection Sunday. We're going to have Palm Sunday and then Resurrection Sunday. And we'll probably have some scripture readings for that. And we'll probably be taking a little break from 1 Corinthians. But we'll be coming back. The key is keep reading your Bible. You know what? The book of Philippians, pretty good book. Chapter 1, pretty awesome chapter. I'm really looking forward to it. So as you witness to people, as you are called to, and I know you're going to do it, whether you know it or not, I know you're going to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ this week. Just because you've identified yourself as a Christian. Even if you don't even talk about Jesus to the people you are around, you will be a witness. So as you do that, think about what Paul said today and how you should love them. You should love them so much that you'd give up anything you're doing if you thought it was going to hurt them. You see what I'm saying? Think about that. Stand if you would. Let's dismiss. Early today. We have time to fellowship is what I used to say. You weren't planning on getting out of here for 8 minutes, which means you should be standing around talking to one another for 8 minutes. Amen. Not running to get first in line at the lunch line. Yes. God loves you. Just know that God loves you. And God loved you so much that he made a church to reach out to you, right? The church found you. If you're in church, if you're a Christian, the church found you. God found you that way. And if you are not a Christian and you don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, just know that God loves you so much that he died for you. He sent the Lord Jesus on this earth to die on a cross for your sins. And his salvation is available whenever you are ready. And you know when you're ready? Right now. Today's the day of salvation. Don't let it go another day. Bow your heads if you would. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your word. Your word that just, it's a love letter. It just reveals your love to us as we read it. We thank you for preserving it to us all through the ages to right where we're at. And thank you for the faith that you've given each one of us to believe it's real, it's so. Right now, we just want to thank you for all the blessings that we have. And we want to pray for everyone around the world that may be struggling. They may have a hard time worshiping you. We pray that they feel your love now, Father. Help us to be a help where and when we can. I want to pray a spiritual blessing on everyone here in the sanctuary and everyone watching remotely on YouTube. I pray that the Lord blesses you right where you are at and that you feel and know that you are loved. And I'll bless you as you go. I want to say, may the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and give you peace. May he bless you as you go out the doors you go out. And may he bless you as you go into the doors that you go into this week. And in every single place that you find yourself, I pray that he would make you a blessing to the people you're interacting with while he is blessing you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. I need revival.